I did this presentation a few years ago. This is actually a little bit different. This has been updated, plus this includes a little bit of information regarding weather involvement with propagation, and also, since television is now not only necessarily the medium by which people get their information, I talk a little bit about social media, the internet, mobile applications, and whatnot. So this is a chock full presentation. I have a lot of slides. This is obviously a topic that can go for hours upon hours, so I will do my best not to keep you late, and certainly for my sake, as I have an early wake-up call tomorrow. A little bit about me. I am a graduate of Penn State University, and why we were still ranked under Ohio State in the final football polls is beyond me, but that's another story. I do have a Bachelor of Science degree in meteorology. I graduated in 2000. I've been doing this now. 1 week from now will be my 17th anniversary on air among two different stations. I worked in Johnstown, Pennsylvania before I came to Charlottesville, and I've been here for 9 years and hopefully will be here for many more years, as I do love the area, as does my wife. Member National Weather Association. Other things that I've done outside of television involve consulting work with fire departments, firefighting with hazmat situations, chemical gas spills and whatnot, training firefighters on the basics of how weather can impact handling those situations. And I also have the opportunity to serve as an adjunct instructor teaching a natural disasters course, which of course covers a lot of the weather things, hurricanes, tornadoes, basically weather things that kill you. So I had the opportunity to do that. Start off with a quote. I like to throw this out there because I think it's very true. A lot of people like to give us, the meteorologists, a lot of flack because, oh, you guys get paid to make mistakes. Well, at the same time, don't ever make fun of the weather, because the majority of people out there could never start a conversation without it. I mean, you think about the things you can go up to anybody and start talking about without offending them. Weather's one of them, right? And for the record, baseball players have it better. They can hit 3 out of every 10 baseballs for 15 years, compete a lot more money, and make it to a Hall of Fame. So there are better jobs than being a meteorologist and being half right. Big part of what I do is deciphering what's happening in the sky. That looks like a tornado, but being a native of York, Pennsylvania, and being within 15 miles of Three Mile Island nuclear power plant, that is what that is. That is the steam plume coming out of Three Mile Island on a clear sky evening. So, first glance, something would tell you, hey, that's a tornado, but in reality, it's half of the nuclear reactor that's still churning to this day after the meltdown of 79. Cool thing about my job, I get to wear many different hats. I get to do many different things. It depends on the weather, literally. A lot of the time, I get to be a scientist. Being on television, it's my job to make the weather look good and at least present it in a format that looks good and is easy to understand. I'm also a protector of lives, teacher, educator, especially when it comes time to explain severe weather and inform people of what's happening. And that's also where being an informer and messenger comes in. Main job that I do and strive to achieve every single day at work is to protect lives and property. And so that is what I'm there for. Obviously, some days it doesn't apply when it's sunny and 75, but still, my main role, if I have saved lives or at least informed everyone to help keep them safe, then my job has been done well. Communication of weather. Even in the last few years since I've been here, there have been astronomical changes in how people get their weather information. Obviously, ham radio is a big one. Television, radio have been the mainstays for many, many years. There's also been the advent of computers and the internet, which now you can get pretty much everything online. But the last two are really worth noting because these have taken off exponentially, in my opinion, within the last 5 years. You're talking social media, you're talking Facebook, Twitter, you're talking about ways of not necessarily you getting your information, but the information coming to you through these social media outlets. And that's one thing that we as a media outlet, as a TV station, are trying to come to grips with, is that, okay, you may not necessarily turn on our station to get your news, weather, and sports, but there's a way that we can get it to you through your social media feeds, then that's also how we can get the information out and also brand ourselves as a media outlet. One thing that will certainly evolve in the next few years that I feel is in our infancy is mobile technology. People are now watching the weather clips on their mobile phones. We now have our mobile app, which, by the way, shameless plug, just search the word Newsplex on Google Play or the iTunes Store. It's free, it's fun, it's easy, and it's really nice and helps my paycheck if you do. So this is something that will probably take off quite a bit in the coming years here in terms of people getting their information. And the main challenge is trying to get the message of weather out to everyone, especially when things get rough. Any idea what hurricane that is? It's a pretty common one. It's a well-known one from the last...
What, in New Orleans?
Yeah, which one was that?
Katrina.
Yes. That's a satellite view of Hurricane Katrina. So a little bit of weather broad brush here. And again, this is a topic that I can spend hours talking about. But for the sake of time, I'll just talk about the important things that may be relevant, especially to us as ham radio operators. National Weather Service is the only one that is authorized or at least is able to give watches, warnings, and advisories. To sum it up, warning means it's happening or it's about to happen. Watch means there's potential. So I like to think of it as making cookies. If there's a chocolate chip cookie watch, it's, okay, I'm going to get all the ingredients out, put them on a table. Maybe I'll make cookies. Maybe I won't feel like it. But there's a chocolate chip cookie warning. I'm going to put the ingredients together, scoop them out, put them on pans, put them in the oven, bake them, pull them out, and eat them. Maybe get a couple scoops of cookie dough. That's kind of the analogy I like to use. Advisories. Those are issued often. In fact, as we speak until 1 o'clock this morning, tomorrow morning, there is a freezing rain advisory in effect. It's kind of in between watch and warning. I like to think of it as advisories are more nuisance events, things that might be inconvenience. If there is a warning, it's something that's potential to do harm or even kill you. All right, so that's kind of, if you want to rearrange this and put advisory between watch and warning, go ahead. It's probably the best way to view it. Now, watches and warnings can be issued for a multitude of things which are listed below. Obviously, tornado advisories, thunderstorm advisories are not issued, but for flooding, flash flooding, winter weather, fog, freezing rain, high winds, tropical storms, hurricanes, and other things, you will get a multitude of combinations of messages. This is the season where it is cold, it is windy. Things that we talk about include the wind chill. Wind chill is basically the combination of wind and temperature. If I have a hot cup of coffee on this tabletop, after a while, it will cool to room temperature. If I put a fan in front of it, it will cool faster. But no matter how much you cool it or how fast you cool it, it'll never get colder than room temperature. So in the same way, wind chill is basically the combination of how fast your body, it was a combination of wind and temperature, but your body's going to cool faster and you will feel colder the faster the wind is blowing. Heat index, that's what holds true in the summertime. The muggier it is, the more humid it is, the hotter you feel. Your body's natural cooling mechanism is to perspire. The sweat evaporates on your skin. Evaporation is a cooling process, and therefore you cool off. Well, there's a lot of moisture in the air. Your body's not going to, the sweat's not going to evaporate as quickly, so you're going to feel hotter. Very important to know that both of these things, they only apply to humans and living creatures. So if we're talking about wind chills one night of, say, 30 below zero, but your car antifreeze is rated at 20 below and the temperature's only 5 above, well, your radiator's not going to freeze because the 30 below is only what it feels like to humans. It's just the wind will cool it off to an ambient temperature of 5 degrees faster for your radiator. So in that case, it does not apply. Other things we talk about, and hey, how well timed, because we have our freezing rain advisory in effect. Sleet and freezing rain. Sleet is rain that's frozen before it hits the ground. Makes a little pinging sound as it falls. Rain is water that's so cold that as soon as it hits something, it freezes on contact. So when you're talking about creating your sheets of ice on surfaces, on railings, on sidewalks, on roads, freezing rain is what does it. Both of these are very tough to predict in the sense that they're kind of like a good soup. A little too much salt and the whole soup batch is ruined. Same is true with sleet and freezing rain, but when you get them in just the right amounts and all the ingredients in the right amounts, yeah, they can create a lot of havoc. And freezing rain is certainly, in terms of potential for being more dangerous, a lot higher, in my opinion, than sleet. Other things we worry about, blizzards. Butterfinger is my personal preference. Actually is a definition as established by the National Weather Service, and that would be for 3 hours, sustained or gusts up to 35 miles per hour, and snow, doesn't matter how much you get, but it has to be snowing so hard that visibility is reduced to less than a quarter of a mile. So that, per the National Weather Service, is the definition of a blizzard. So you know, think about blizzards of the past, well, they had to meet that criteria for it to happen. Being from Pennsylvania and being having spent 8 years in the mountains of West Central Pennsylvania, where we averaged 80 to 100 inches of snow per winter, coming here to Charlottesville was a bit of a treat. The average snowfall here, not counting the elevations, generally ranges between 16 and 21 inches. And officially, we've had at McCormick Observatory 2 inches, and in the city, 2.5 inches. That's what we got this past weekend. Mountains, you're talking about 20 to 40 inches, and of course, the opportunity for a lot more. And certainly, Wintergreen hopes for a lot more than that to keep in business. Snowiest winter we ever had, shortly after I got here. Sorry, it's all my fault. 57 inches nearly in the winter of 2009-2010. And I'll never forget that because the first of those three storms, the Friday before Christmas in 2009, yeah, we didn't think it would happen till late at night. First flakes fell 4 p.m. on a Friday afternoon. By 5 o'clock, there are already 2 inches of snow on the ground. So everyone's leaving work, heading out of town for the holidays. It was kind of messy, needless to say. Earliest measurable snow in this area was actually October 10th, 1979. And that's notable because it was also the night of the first game of the World Series between the Pirates and the Orioles. They had to postpone that game because it was so cold and because it was snowing. And, of course, our boy TJ, gotta, you know, throw him in there somewhere. The earliest large snowstorm on record, he actually made that notation in 1772 of 3 feet accumulating. And again, talking about December 18th and 19th, 2009, we happen to be in the order of about 18 to 30 inches just in a very short area. So that was, it got the snow season started in a very, very robust way, if you will. Other things I talk about, certainly things that are of note to keep people safe, is lightning, not lightening. No E's in lightning. Three kinds. Lightning that goes from cloud to the ground. You've also got lightning that goes from one cloud to another cloud. And you've got lightning that goes from one part of the cloud to yet another. You've probably heard of heat lightning before. There's no such thing. In fact, in reality, lightning bolt is about 5 times hotter than the surface of the sun. So it's kind of hot by nature. Average length of a lightning bolt is about 5 to 10 miles from the research that I've done, but some lightning bolts can be a lot longer. You're talking kiloamps of power, and of all the things weather-related that can do harm or kill people, lightning is up there in the top three, along with flooding and heat. It's one of my pet peeves, just to let you know. You talk about Florida, they average 1,000 thunderstorms per year. Lightning is very unique in terms of safety and what it does in terms of harming people is to just kill one person at a time. Sorry for the blunt language, but I can't really think of any other way to put it in meteorological terms. You talk about, I think the exact number is 26%, but one in every four lightning deaths happens in open spaces. You probably heard the 5-second rule in terms of determining how far away a storm is. A lot of people forget the 5 part. As soon as you see lightning, start counting. 1,000, 2,000, keep going until you hear the thunder. That'll give you a number. Take that number, divide by 5. That new number is how many miles away the thunderstorm is. And people forget to divide by 5, but it takes sound 5 seconds to go 1 mile. So you have to throw that in there. So if it's 25 seconds, it's pretty easy. It's 5 miles away. Am I going too fast? Like I said, I got a lot of stuff. I just want to make sure I get it all here. Thunderstorms, they can form in different ways. You can get your warm air that gets pushed up from a cold front, or you can just get the sun coming out on a typical summer day. Hot air, warm air rises, clashes with moisture, cooler air. You get storms that look like anvils, like in that picture. 3 phases of a thunderstorm. You've got updrafts, or at least the convection phase. Convection is a 50-cent word for warm air rising. So you think of a convection oven. That's all a convection oven is. It's just warm air rising. Mature thunderstorm has air going up and coming down. And the dissipation stage, when a thunderstorm dies, it just kind of lets out its last breath. It just goes, oh, okay, that's it. All the air collapses out of a thunderstorm into one big downdraft. Sometimes it can do so forcefully that you get microbursts, kind of like we had on June 24th, 2012. All the air comes down, just comes out from underneath the thunderstorm very quickly. You can get straight line wind gusts of 60, 70, 80, 100, 120 plus miles per hour. And a lot of people think when we have microbursts, oh, well, we had 80 mile an hour winds, had to be a tornado. Not necessarily. You can have faster winds in a microburst than you can in some weak tornadoes. And that's what happened on June 24th in 2012. Or maybe it was 2010. It was 2010. Forgive me. June 24th, 2010. All the air came out. It did so forcefully that you had surface wind gusts upwards of 70 miles per hour. A lot of things can happen with thunderstorms. You can get thunder, you can get lightning, you can get very heavy rain, you can get damaging straight line winds, you can get large hail, you can get tornadoes. Thunderstorms can be individual, they can be in lines, they can be in clusters. If you ever remember playing Ring Around the Rosie when you were younger, imagine thunderstorms doing the same over the open ocean water. That's how hurricanes form. They all kind of gel together into one little storm that starts spinning around. Talking about lines of thunderstorms, squall lines, lines of thunderstorms that have one thing lifting all the air up, like a cold front. It's a pretty common terminology there. A bow echo looks like a bow and arrow. It's just a bent line of thunderstorms. Derechos, ah yes, that was from June 29th, 2012. See, meteorology is full of all sorts of dates. It's kind of hard to keep them straight. This is a map of the progression of the derecho that happened on June 29th. And these numbers in these boxes are wind speeds. So that's Gary, Indiana. You've got Toledo, Ohio is up around here. So you had 80, 90 mile an hour wind gusts. You moved across 8 p.m. and I'll never forget too. It was about 9:15 when it hit here and I was watching the radar. It looked like a massive line of storms, but I remember going from zero to holy cow, it's windy outside in about 2 seconds. And I'll never forget this too because I live by Azalea Park. We did not get one drop of rain. Looked menacing on radar. How do we classify derechos? It's kind of like tornadoes. We can't classify it until it's happening or after it's happened. And the technical terminology and definition of a derecho is a long-lived windstorm that does significant wind damage of at least 240 miles or more. So this definitely fit the bill. So we kind of knew it was happening after the first 240 miles. What caused it? You actually had a weakening cold front that still held together, and you had a lot of wind coming very quickly from the east up over it, kind of overrunning it. It just helped fuel things. Thunderstorms are also very finicky beasts because decaying thunderstorms, the wind comes out of a thunderstorm, it can actually generate new thunderstorms in the same place. We call that training. Johnstown flood of 1977, that's what happened. For 12 straight hours, they had one thunderstorm after another generate in the same exact place. And I think in 11 hours, they had over 12 inches of rain. So they can kind of breathe themselves, if you will. Hail, like to think of this as just water droplets that are getting blown up. They freeze. They kind of bump into other water droplets and grow into little balls of ice, and then they sink, and then they get blown up, and then they get so big and heavy to the point where the updrafts can't hold them, and they fall to the ground as chunks of ice. It can be really small. Here's a nice little visual of hail, by the way. Air goes up, water droplets freeze, they bond with others, they become balls of ice, and then they fall. That's a picture of the largest hailstone ever recorded. That was from July of 2010 in Vivian, South Dakota. That's 8 inches in diameter. And it's basically a little bit larger than a grapefruit. So you can imagine a grapefruit-sized chunk of ice falling from the sky. It's going to hurt. Big problem for those that own livestock out in the plains. It does not necessarily have to be a tornadic thunderstorm, but if you get thunderstorms that are producing large hail and chunks of ice that are falling on livestock, there's no shelter around, yeah. Lots of livestock are killed because of this every single year in such storms. But it's a good time to buy a used car because if there's hail damage, car dealer can't sell it as new. So keep that in mind. Supercells, nothing more than a spinning thunderstorm. You can have updrafts that are very fast. These don't always produce tornadoes, but they can produce them with very little or no warning. Tornadoes can be skinny. They can be wide. There can be storms that produce tornadoes in multiple fashions, several at one time. Things I look for on radar to determine whether there is a tornado or the possibility of a tornado is as such. This is an image from mid-June of 2008. So this was a few months after I got here. Here's Gordonsville. This was one particular thunderstorm that decided to develop in Madison County and just kind of drifted to the southeast. You notice this little hook, all right? The more intense colors are indicating the more intense precipitation. So the blue and the green is fairly light stuff, but then you start getting into the reds and the purples, and that's very intense precipitation. What happens is the wind tends to curl around if it starts to get spinning. Well, it also tends to curl the rain around a little bit into this little hook. So if I see these little hooks on radar, chances are that could be a storm that in many cases will produce or has the potential to produce a tornado. Chances are right around, say, in here. And this storm did actually produce one, but it did so over the Fredericksburg area. So it was a very weak one. That is just in its infant stages. That's like the baby picture of tornadoes, if you will. There's a better example. Speaking of Oklahoma City, this is an image from May 2003. Don't know if you were there at that time, but there's a tornado right there. That red dot. So if I'm looking at a radar image and I see that, hopefully I've warned some people along the way, because that's a little easier to find. But again,
velocity fields, but we could talk about that all
the time. Oh yeah, velocity fields, I'm just keeping this simple. But yeah, you talk about inbound, outbound, spin. I mean, there's a lot of different things, but if I see something like that, by all means, there's a problem. As mentioned, clusters of thunderstorms over the water that hold hands, spin around, call those hurricanes. That's another image of Katrina from many years ago. Obviously, the one around here that has a big impact, Hurricane Camille, and this is from the Nelson County Museum. That is the Tie River, by the way. So all the water came down the Tie River, carried everything, including that car. The water receded, and the car is still left hanging in a tree. Now comes the fun part of the program, weather and relevance to what we do as ham radio operators. And I will credit most of this information from this website, which is a collection of government manuals describing different techniques about how to do things. This is a particular module that they had on electrical nature stuff, including radio and whatnot. So we are certainly at the mercy of radio bands, and being new to HF myself in general class is something I'm still learning, and of course will probably learn until my dying day. But in terms of just basic things that happen, in terms of the weather, in a perfect world, if we had totally dry air, no moisture whatsoever, life will be great. But around here especially, that isn't always the case. We have to deal with water, be it in vapor form, or little water droplets, or raindrops, or snow, or hail. There really aren't any rules that are hard and fast in determining, well, if it's foggy or if visibility is a quarter mile, propagation is cut by this percent. And that's because the weather by nature is so dynamic and it's always changing. Likewise, when you start talking about the influence of snow, well, snow can be like we saw this past weekend. We had very, very, very fine grains of snow. Had they been bigger, we'd have gotten a lot more snow accumulation like they did in Hampton Roads. My sister in Pocosin measured 13 inches. It's like a two-hour drive from here. So the rules are, it's kind of like weather itself. It's tough to get a hold on sometimes, but there are some generalizations that we can make along the way. One thing I found very interesting from this publication is that attenuation due to precipitation is generally proportionate to the frequency. So you're talking much higher frequencies, especially in the gigahertz band. You're going to be having more problems with attenuation and scattering and more of an influence with the weather than you would with lower frequencies. So it's actually to our benefit to be doing 160, 80, 40, 20 meters as opposed to in much higher frequencies. Raindrops, what they tend to do is they absorb the power put out. So if this is your tower, you're putting out power, there's your wavefront. Well, the water droplets are going to absorb a little power, plus they're going to scatter some of the energy itself. So by the time the signal actually gets to its designated target, it's going to be a lot weaker. So that being something that we have to fight. Think of fog as well. Fog is nothing more than a little water droplet. So fog will also have a big impact in terms of attenuation and also scattering. Again, snow, snowflakes can be big. They can be small. They can be very dry. It can be very dry, fluffy, powdery snow. Or it can be like the snow they're having right now in the Sierra Nevadas, where they have gotten, oh, what's the number? I think I want to say like 15 feet in the last 2 weeks. And this coming after two incredibly snow-free years. I mean, last year
They had nothing. I've got a friend that lives in Truckee, California, and she sent me pictures from last year of like in February, and there's no snow on the ground. And now this year, total opposite. So snow can have an effect, although that's when we come to the assumption of things that, all right, attenuation is less than rain. Just because snowflakes are less dense and they have a little bit less water than a raindrop, so they won't have as great an effect. But again, there's no hard, fast rule to the impact that snow could have on attenuation and scattering. Hail is the same way. Size and density of hail will certainly have an effect as well. Now, this is something that I've actually been working with since I was little. My inspiration radio came from being a little seven-year-old in Thomasville, Pennsylvania, having a little FM radio antenna. I could pick up DC radio stations, York, Harrisburg, Lancaster. I could pick up Baltimore. I could pick up Philadelphia. Had a little dowel and a copper wire outside my bedroom window, and I could DX from everywhere, and it was great. And there were some times I'm like, hey, I can get those Philadelphia stations a lot better than I can from, you know, even just across town. I remember being in Johnstown once, and I got a station one morning in Winnipeg, or in Canada. And that's always fascinated me. Well, it's because inversions have a lot to do with it. In the normal convention of the atmosphere, the traditional rule of thumb is that the higher you go, the colder it gets. Well, an inversion is actually a layer where the temperatures actually increase with height. It's almost like a little lid. Sometimes on really cold, clear nights, you look off in the distance and you see someone's smokestack from a fireplace. It goes up and then just kind of levels off. Yeah, well, it's hit the inversion. It can't go up through because that's an air mass of a different density. So it's kind of like a cap, if you will. Well, these caps, or these inversions, if you will greatly affect attenuation of beams. Now, again, this image being from the website link I showed earlier. If you have a duct of cold air, all right, kind of stretching along the surface, if you don't have it, you put out a signal from a tower, it can just go off and off and off. But what's going to happen is in your cold air duct with warm air just above it, this warm air acts like a lid. So when this radio wave hits this air mass of a different density, it's going to bounce back, and this can just keep bouncing and bouncing and bouncing for however long it wants to, whatever conditions in that duct want to warrant, be it across state or halfway across the North American continent or even halfway around the world. So inversions, they form usually at nighttime. What's happening is when the sun goes down, the earth cools off, and the heat that it's absorbed during the day actually re-radiates back up the atmosphere. And that heat is what forms this warm layer and kind of traps that cold layer underneath it. Does that make sense? So that's why a lot of times, late at night on a clear, cold night, or even early in the morning, while these inversions tend to be in place, are good times to do HF stuff, because it can help the signal scatter around quite a bit. So taking everything I've discussed, and I think it's a record as far as time. As far as meteorology, as far as radio, as far as communication, just taking everything and just putting a little sack, or, you know, like in the movie Sword in the Stone, where the sorcerer has all of his little things miniaturized and fit in a little carry-on bag, if only packing were that easy. Where do we go from here? I will be the first to admit, we as meteorologists make mistakes. Don't act shocked. Really, it's okay. In my opinion, I don't think we'll ever be 100% accurate, because there are so many nuances and little quirks about the atmosphere and terrain and things that happen on a local scale. But that's not going to stop us from trying, because technology is getting better every day. In fact, a couple weeks ago, they just launched a new satellite that, when operational, will give us a very big forecasting advantage, and certainly in terms of imagery from space in satellites. It'll be a lot faster than it's been. Communication is the big key. This is where I come into play. This is where all of us come into play as far as getting information out, being involved in Skywarn, being involved in Aries. There's certainly discussion about short and long-term weather and climate issues. That's something that we have probably heard time and time again, and will continue to do so in the future. We will also have to deal, and I say not deal, but we will also have to work concurrently with people that I refer to as social media meteorologists. And those are the types of people where they may have Facebook pages and try and post computer predictions of what's going to happen for, you know, 3 weeks in advance of a 30-inch snowstorm, but conventional meteorology says that it's like a Plinko board on Price is Right. The farther that puck has to fall through the pegs, well, the possibility of what could happen are endless.
If we shrink that Plinko board, it's like short-term forecasting. That peg doesn't have, or that chip doesn't have as far to fall. But forecasting is a lot like a Plinko board. The longer out you try and predict, the bigger the board is, then the myriad of possibilities greatly increase as to what can actually happen farther in the future. I have no problem with people trying to get weather information out or working together to make sure that everyone is safe. I can only just hope that people that are not necessarily meteorologists know their limitations. I know a lot of people who are hobbyists in the field who, once a big storm comes or they blow a forecast or they have been accused of piping things, they will retreat and say, oh, I'm just a hobbyist. That's great, but here's the thing. Meteorology is a big business. People's lives and properties are at stake. It's something I've taken very seriously for 17 years. I was once, and this is not to toot my own horn, but this is just an example. When I was in Johnstown, one night I was the only forecaster of the three of us in the area to predict frost. We got frost. Nursery called me up the same day and said, hey, because we listened to you and because you called for frost and we got it, you saved us $30,000 because we didn't lose our plants. We could protect them and we saved them. So if an accurate forecast is $30,000 of savings to a nursery, it's important to VDOT if they need to send crews out and pay them to go plow roads and take care of surfaces. It's a big deal. I mean, people live and die by good or bad forecasts. So I can only hope that people know the limitations and that we can all work together to protect lives and property and not necessarily scare the you-know-what out of people, which unfortunately is something I see more and more of literally by the month, especially in the winter time. There will be constant evolution of how we get our weather information. NOAA weather radios, they still work. Towers on Fan Mountain got a pretty good signal into this area. Ham radio was very important with weather communications in the days following Hurricane Katrina and also Colorado flooding of 2013. There was a really good write-up in the QST about that happening, I think, late in 2013, where all forms of communication were down in Katrina and ham radio was the only way to communicate. And likewise, finding out whereabouts of loved ones are getting help in Colorado flooding of 2013. So will ham radio ever go away in weather? I don't think so. I don't think it'll ever go away, period. It may be primitive compared to some of the other mentions of communication, but when all else fails, it's still going to work. All you need is an HT in your hand and frequency and a call sign, and you're good to go. Television, as mentioned, this is something that we are evolving with as our technology is going to mobile and cellular. And who knows what's going to happen a few years from now? I mean, the social media revolution with weather has only been about the last 5, 6, 7 years. Who knows what's going to happen in 10 years from now? It's going to become another form of communication for everyone to get their weather information or whatever. So we can only hope. In summary, sometimes it may all be a crock of you-know-what, but we do our best. And yes, there really is a place. I've been there, yeah. And it does freeze over in the wintertime. In fact, the Detroit TV stations will actually feature it on their temperature maps, and if the temperature's below freezing, they can legitimately say that hell is frozen over.
Is it in UP, or where is it?
No, it's actually about 45 minutes north of Ann Arbor. It's at the end of Darwin Road. I'm not kidding. Darwin Road runs into hell. The nearest town is called Pinckney, by the way. If you want to Google Maps, it's called Pinckney, Michigan, and it's a little bit south and west. So please, questions. Bring them on. Yes, Joe?
It seems to me that weather forecasting is getting more and more accurate. I listen to these forecasts, and you're getting more and more to the point of what exactly time it's likely to rain, and it's just getting terrific. So in summary, then I'd have to say, you guys have to have the courage of your convictions.
Where's the rim shot when I need it? Well, first of all, thank you. And I tend to agree with you. I mean, it's been since 2000 since I graduated college. So, I mean, a myriad of stuff has changed since I got out of Penn State. A lot of what we use is computer guidance to help guide us along as to what could happen. We're not really supposed to use them as a crutch to make the forecast because these model predictions can be wrong. But there are a lot of them that have gotten really good in the short term and on a very small scale. And it certainly works to our advantage. One thing I find interesting, too, is everyone always says, oh, well, you know, it's really tough to forecast for this area.
I think every area is kind of tough to forecast for, even San Diego, California, because they've got a myriad of microclimates too. And you don't have to go far away from San Diego before you're out in the San Joaquin Valley or even in Death Valley. So, and that's kind of the fascination to me. It's like a big puzzle. It's like, okay, your puzzle pieces are the entire atmosphere. Put them together and decide what's going to happen in Charlottesville the next 24 or 168 hours. And I agree. I think it only can get better. I only see good things in the future, especially with the GOES-R satellite and with anything else that will come along. I mean, it's we've certainly not gotten worse. Yes?
I moved down here from, I was 14 years in Homer, Alaska.
Ah.
The weather up there was spiritual because you had Ketchikan Bay right there.
Mm-hmm.
That was like 54 degrees all year round.
Yep.
And then right on the other side of Ketchikan Bay, about 8 miles across the bay, you had the Harding Ice Fields, which are one of the largest ice fields in North America. So you had, the weather there was insane.
Yeah.
Next to impossible to ever predict.
And isn't part of the area around Juneau classified as a rainforest as well?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you don't think of Alaska having a rainforest, but climatologically speaking, that's what it's classified as. Yeah.
One of the things that struck me down here is just what just happened with this last snowfall. You know, the philosophy here with snow removal for VDOT is we're going to scrape it down to nothing, then put the chemicals on it so we can make black ice for you.
Yeah.
Because, you know, everybody gives warnings about black ice. Mm-hmm. Like, well, who made it? VDOT did.
Yeah.
Because in Alaska, we never use chemicals. We always put sand out, and everybody went along their merry way. They didn't try to melt it. You didn't fight nature. You just let it, you know, do its thing. Challenge with that is you end up with a lot of sand in the spring that needs cleaned up. But here, it almost, I guess what I'm getting at in a long-winded question slash comment, because I'm trying to understand the logic of why VDOT, if you have a forecast that says it's going to get down to, oh my God, you got to be kidding me, in temperature, why do they put down something that has a melting point, but they know it's going to freeze again when it hits 12 degrees? Yeah.
Salt only works to 18 degrees Fahrenheit.
Sure. So why do they use,
exactly.
I don't know if it's not a 12, I think, but the point is, why do they do that? When they should know what's
going to
happen based on your forecast.
Yeah.
You're in the old Dominion, Bob.
And that is
check your brain at the door, you know.
And that is certainly a question beyond my scope, even though I'm good friends with Lou Hatter. But I will say this, you do bring up an interesting point. It's not necessarily the big snow events that are a problem, but it's the small ones, especially what happens at 4 o'clock on a Friday before Christmas.
Yeah.
And I think in the case of this snow was, generally speaking, Buckingham County removed, they got about 5 to 8 county wide. But in this area, we got about 1 to 3. And because of the way, and one thing that we now have to look for, we do analyze in terms of making snow predictions, at least I do, is what kind of snow is it going to be? Is it going to be a small granular kind of flake that's going to be a lot but not make much? Is it going to be bigger flakes? Is it going to be a wetter snow, a drier snow? And what happened was, you had this snow. As soon as I stepped outside my front door and left the footprint, temperatures were so far below freezing that it just froze. So whether you drove on it one time or stepped someplace quickly, it turned to ice. And with temperatures being below freezing up until about 3 hours ago, I mean, nothing has had a chance to melt. So those are all things to consider as meteorologists when we make these forecasts. And I know that it's very complicated in terms of trying to plow all the roads or which to treat or which to take care of. And sometimes you can only do so much when your chemical that might be the most expensive, you know, only works at 12 degrees. Because if it gets colder than that, then nothing's going to work.
And we're limited, too, in our language. You know, in Alaska, between the Tlingits, the Aleuts, and the Eskimos, they've got almost 40 words for snow.
Yeah.
And here we just say, icy snow, slushy snow.
Mm-hmm.
You have to modify it in English.
Right.
But up there, you know, they have all the different, you know, words.
Wow. And one thing that amazes me after, again, being a Pennsylvania native is as soon as you mention flurries down here, boom, everyone's going to the store, stockpiling it. It's a French toast forecast. It's bread, milk, eggs, butter, and toilet paper, and they're gone. Never fails.
In PA, we're buying Iron City and Wise Potato Chips.
Right.
Exactly. Exactly. Yes.
I'm going to change the subject.
Okay.
So, cell phones, mobile devices.
Yes.
So, how does forecasting change when everybody's cell phone is providing weather observations to feed into
more data points
to what you do?
More data points. One thing we like to say too, and I'm hearing this more and more increasingly, is, oh well, my mobile app, or what, the weather section of my iPhone said today was going to be 55 degrees. A lot of those weather apps are actually generated from directly from computer models. Yes, I use computer models to help make a forecast, but I'm like the quality control. In fact, a meteorologist is quality control, because I can look at all the models that I need to make a forecast. I can either agree with them or say, all right, this one's kind of got a good track record in the wintertime, I'm going to use this, or I can say, I think they're all bad, and I can make my own forecast. So my mobile app, for example, with me and David Reese and our new weekend guy who will be starting in a few weeks, I think it's the best way to describe it is we do quality control. But mobile apps are great because there are several of them now where you can contribute to current information. I know some people that have their weather stations at their homes wired through Weather Underground. I mean, I work in a dark, this is the funny part of my job. I work in a dark, windowless studio to predict what's happening outside for 9 counties in Central Virginia. Think about that for a minute. So the more eyes that I have, and I'll tell you, my shameless plug again, my Twitter handle is @TravisKoshko. Especially in wintertime, severe weather. People tell me things to verify what I'm seeing or to say, hey, radar says snow, but we're not seeing anything. Like this morning, my radar was lit up with blue indicating snow, but the air was so dry, everything was evaporating and didn't hit the ground. So I had people tell me, no, we're not seeing snow. The more eyes I have and the more observations I get, the more of a complete data set I get and the more information I have to make an accurate forecast. So yes, it's very valuable. So just getting observations. Now, there are people, having said that, that I've dealt with in the past, not so much here, but their idea of measuring snow is going out in a drift under their garage roof, or sticking the ruler in sideways, or reading the scent. This has happened once. My friend Samantha, who used to work in Richmond, got a picture where they measured it from the centimeter line, not the inches. It said 10 inches, but it was 10 centimeters. Big difference. So after a while, you learn, okay, if you get repeat customers who give you information, you know, okay, I can trust them, or thanks for watching. Yeah. You know, so again, like, and even with the data that I get, I do quality control. Great question. Yes.
The zero on the Fahrenheit scale was established from saturated solution of brine sodium chloride.
Mm-hmm.
When it was thought that that was the coldest temperature that could be produced.
Mm-hmm.
I think calcium chloride is commonly used on the roads, which has a different a freezing point. What it is, I don't have a clue.
I don't know the exact number, but I also know that calcium chloride is a lot more expensive.
Okay.
And that's why it's used sparingly. So again, getting back to the, you know, how does VDOT treat the roads? I know there's cost analysis. I know that, I mean, you could put calcium chloride in every road and it's not going to freeze, but how much is it going to cost you? Right. You know, so that's I know is an equation they've got to weigh a lot of the times. It's almost like a restaurant. You don't want to make too much food in one day and have leftovers. You just want to make just the right amount for all the customers that are coming to your door, so you don't have any leftover. You want to just get it just right. Just like with power companies. I have a friend who's a meteorologist for Duke Energy in North Carolina. They actually have to forecast, basically, even 1 degree off could cost Duke Energy thousands upon thousands of dollars, because they either have to make more electricity or they have to go to other power companies and buy it, which costs them more money, because of course they're not going to get it at the same price that they would get if they were to make it themselves. So again, using other industries as an example, like forecasting is big business. I mean, it's taken seriously. I guarantee the airlines take it even more seriously than I do.
Trucking companies,
wins. Uh-huh. Those big construction cranes in the cities, they can't work those above like 35 or 40 miles an hour. You know, there are wind thresholds for those, and there's insurance. I mean, there's forensic meteorology, which is fun. I've actually written depositions for trials where weather has been a factor in murder cases. I've done that before. Anywhere you can think of the weather applying to any field. I mean, so yes, I do TV, but meteorology in general is just a huge, vast array. I mean, TV is just one of the branches of the tree of meteorology. Yes.
Can you speak a little bit about these European models versus U.S. models? And
yes.
How that all plays.
Okay. A large part of what we use to help make forecasts in the future are called computer models or computer guidance.
These are computers that crunch numbers and equations and take things into terrain into account, water, and try and formulate what will happen in the future. There are many different models that cover different time frames. There's one that goes just 12 hours out. There are some computer models that go several days in the future. There are others that go several weeks and several months. The two big ones that we use, there's the American model called the GFS, and then there's the European model. All right. Especially in the last few years, there's been a lot of talk about the European model being more accurate and more sophisticated, largely because to get the European model and to have access to it, you have to pay for it. So that money goes directly into more computing power, more advancements, whereas the American computer model is not as financially backed as the Euro model. A lot of people, especially within the last 12 months, actually, I'd say even the last few years, really tout up the Euro, as I call it, the European model, as being the more accurate, especially in terms of hurricanes or snowstorms. But it's been my observation otherwise, it's more of about a 50-50 split. I choose not to put all my eggs in one basket when I forecast. And again, that's where being a meteorologist comes in, is part of my education was how these models come to their conclusions of what they predict, what the atmosphere actually does. Sometimes the computer models can't pick what happened. They can't predict the fact that lines of thunderstorms will totally collapse once they hit the Blue Ridge Mountains, pretty much hop over us and then reform in Louisa County and go east. You know, so those are things that after being in area and forecasting for a while, you pick up as a human being, and you keep that in mind when you forecast.
You get the model output from the National Meteorological Center, right? They run both models.
Yes, they do. Plus our private vendor that provides the information for our computer graphics system, our weather graphics system, they give us that information too. So there are a number of different sources that we can get all the computer models from. Sometimes they're right, sometimes they're wrong. I choose, and I think what's lost too is, and I see this on social media all the time, is you will get someone who posts an image from the European model for 384 days in the future, which is like, what, 2 weeks or beyond? It's like, oh, the Euro for 2.5 weeks out is predicting a 30-inch snowstorm. That's 2.5 weeks away, you know? And I'm going to use this analogy that will make you laugh, but there is truth to it. I use the Plinko analogy. Forecasting is a lot like a dartboard, and I say that in this term. This is the dartboard, and I'm standing right here. Pretty good chance I can hit the bullseye, right? Farther I step away from this dartboard, the tougher it gets to hit the bullseye. Likewise, the Plinko chip. If you want to go to the $10,000 slot in the bottom, well, the higher up you are, your odds are greatly reduced of hitting that. And likewise, the farther in the future you try and predict, the tougher it is to be accurate, because so many things can change. Realistically, I tend to think of forecasting being fairly accurate out to about 3 or 4 days. But Travis, why do you have a 7-day forecast on TV? Because people always want to know the weekend, and the weekend's always in view.
Do both models use similar data sets for the input radar pilots report?
I think they do. I don't know too much about their initialization, but presumably yes. It's just a matter of how they calculate them. It's almost like if I tell you, all right, get from here to Crozet. You're going to take 250 or you're going to take 64. You know, you'll get to Crozet eventually. Maybe you won't. Maybe you'll end up in Botetourt County somewhere. I don't know. Yes?
We were moving my daughter into an apartment in Blacksburg.
Mm-hmm.
And helping was a friend of hers who was a meteorology student there. And he had an app of some kind on his cell phone. And he would occasionally glance down and say, well, we've got time to go down to the car and bring one more load up because it's going to start raining in 3 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And darn if he wasn't right. And I asked him, well, you know, how can you do that at that exceptional accuracy? He said the radar that was available in the Blacksburg area is some of the best. And he knew all the problems, so when he said, we don't have anything like it here.
Yeah.
Is that the case?
Yes. Here's the scoop. We unfortunately are in a bit of a radar void in Charlottesville. The three that we use on air, the one comes from Blacksburg, the other's in Wakefield by the Virginia Diner, if you've ever been down there in 460, and the other one's in Sterling. So we're in the middle of a triangle. What happens, and this goes along the lines of attenuation and whatnot, and I know you're far more qualified to talk about this than I am.
It's not attenuation, it's terrain.
Right.
And plus, what happens with the radar beams is, radar beam scans the sky, kind of like a police officer has a radar gun to measure your speed on the road. What happens with these radar sights is, they're set at angles to scan the sky. What happens to the beam as they get farther away from the radar sight is they start to bend upward. So by the time the radar beams get here, the lowest they are is about 13, 14,000 feet. So anything that happens in this area under 14,000 feet is oftentimes not going to be picked up by radar.
Can I correct you on one thing?
Yes, please.
Your results are correct, but the reason is wrong. First of all, on a normal day, due to what's known as central radio propagation lab model, the beam always bends slightly, reducting it, bends like that. But the reason, say the lowest tilt is Stirling, which is a half a degree, by the time you get out to Charlottesville, the bottom of that beam could be 20,000 feet. It's really due to Earth's curvature.
Well, that's what you're
saying. Okay, yeah.
Yeah. Along those lines, yeah. It's not a straight line like that the whole way. There are factors that bend the beam regardless.
Is the growth in high-rise buildings in Washington, D.C. is causing tremendous blockage in this area.
Mm-hmm. And I know, too, that there tends to be a giant radar void in Madison County. And that's been confirmed by the National Weather Service meteorologists, too. So whatever I see in Madison County is usually a little worse is actually happening than what the radar indicates. That app, by the way, I think the one he was talking about was RadarScope, which I have, which I think is downloadable for iTunes and for Android. Now that we have a better mobile app, I tend to use mine. But for the more detailed stuff, yes, RadarScope is probably the one he was using.
But it wouldn't pay for us to use it here, I think he said, because the radar information is just not as good as it would be in Black.
I wouldn't totally agree with that statement, because I think you'll still see what's heading in this general direction. It's just under a certain level, if there's something happening like 14 or 20,000 feet, it may not do as well. Yeah, but as far as timing, like a line of storms, I found it to be pretty good. You know, just being, and the nice thing is you get the pro side of having three different radars is I get three different views of it. So I can kind of, check and balance with each other rather than relying on one. So timing-wise, as far as things coming here, the radars do pretty well. But as far as what's happening at certain levels of the atmosphere, that's where I would start to think that, okay, it is better closer to the radar sites as opposed to being, I think 56 miles as the crow flies is the nearest radar, and that's Stirling, So very good question. AJ.
So are we going to get more radar as population increases in the Charlottesville area? Are we going to get a radar, tower?
The tough thing is, along what he said, is there's no, and I, again, talking with the National Weather Service, there's no place around here to put a radar.
Right.
Because if you put it on top of the mountain, you're going to be already several thousand feet above everything else and beaming up. But if you put it on the ground, it's going to hit the mountains.
The Weather Service has approximately 166 radars in the U.S., including Hawaii, Alaska, and the Caribbean. Mm-hmm. And their goal was east of the Mississippi to have coverage down to 8,000 feet. That's not true in all cases. And west, think of the Rockies, 10,000 feet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because terrain's a huge part of it, but around here.
The sighting was basically they use satellite imaging to say we're going to have a denser network where there's more city lights, more population.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so unless someone's got about $2.6 million to spend, or if you bought on Amazon Prime, $2,599,999, exactly. Yeah, Dave.
Anybody in this area that's been involved with Skywarn's probably gotten a phone call from Stirling or somewhere wanting to know what conditions were like on the ground, because they
can't see it.
Yeah, and
But really, what I wanted to ask you is, what's the relation between you as a local forecaster and the National Weather Service? They just provide the data that you use?
They don't provide all the data, but we kind of collaborate together. If you want to view them as competition, you can, but I don't. I view them more as a partnership. They do provide a lot of the information that I will eventually pass on, like watches, warnings, advisories. We will collaborate on forecasts together. We do things concurrently. We do outreach. Locals will oftentimes be involved in the Skywarn program, and if you're not involved in Skywarn, I encourage every single one of you, if you just send in snowfall reports, it makes our job so much easier. But it's
one of those relationships where we can be as involved as we want to be or as minimally involved as we want to be. So we have a pretty good relationship with all three offices. We have three offices that cover our viewing area, Blacksburg, Sterling, and Wakefield. So we have good relationships with all three of them. And we choose to be involved just because we feel that what we can provide them will help them do our jobs, and what they can provide to us will help our help us do ours in keeping people safe.
Yes, this is Sterling is particularly glad to have reports because we are right at the radar edge of all three of the radars.
Exactly. Very much so. Very much so. Yeah.
I'd like to have two questions answered.
Second one will cost you.
How many people in the room have had the Skywarn training? Raise your hand.
Whoa, pretty good. Sound training.
That makes me happy.
How many of you have current numbers?
Oh, current numbers.
Wow. Okay. I'm the net control for Sterling.
Okay.
For Albemarle County. And Jim and I usually come up on the two main repeaters. Mm-hmm. In Albemarle and monitor during nasty weather.
Right.
And I get frequent calls from Sterling for inches of rain, inches of snow, wind velocity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So Sterling has always worked well. And of course, technically, Albemarle is Sterling.
Yes. Right. Fluvanna and Louisa are Wakefield. Buckingham is actually Blacksburg. With the way they align it, but everybody else is Sterling. So six of our nine counties that we cover are Sterling. One is Blacksburg. Two are Wakefield. So it's but if you make reports to any of the three, they will make sure they get the respective office. So yes, the more information we get, the easier it makes our jobs. I mean, we are only as good as the information that we get from eyeballs out there. Yes.
There's a something called CWOP, Civilian Weather Observer Program.
Yes.
You find that useful for local ground troops kind of stuff?
Anything I can get. Really, I mean, as long as you know what you're doing and you know how to measure snow and report and whatnot, yeah.
Well, a lot of them are automated. You get, you know, mm-hmm. You buy a system from Davis or Pete or something.
Yep. Yep, plug them into Weather Underground. Right. Now, Weather Underground works with TV stations to at least proprietarily put the information on air, like NBC 29. They have a partnership, but I can still use the data unofficially to observe what's going on. That makes sense. But still, for me to know that, hey, it's 30 degrees in Wintergreen and it's 15 degrees in Charlottesville means there's a big inversion going on, so that's going to play into the forecast with whatever happens, be it, you know, fog in the morning or you know, freezing precipitation. Yeah, exactly. Very much so. Yes.
I'm kind of curious what your behavior is like in terms of your competitors. Do you look over their shoulders and kind of a, what are they predicting? And in particular, a specific one, do you watch ET out of WeatherRx out of Richmond much? He's a private, renowned private meteorologist, which I understand makes a gargantuan amount of money for Monsanto and so forth.
All right. I'll start one question at a time. This is going to sound weird, but I really don't watch the competition in terms of snowfall. And I say that just because I don't mean for this to sound egotistical or arrogant in any means, but nothing that anyone else says is going to influence the forecast that I feel I'm going to make. You know, I'm not going to make a forecast of 1 to 3 inches and see someone else say 3 to 6 and say, oh, they're going 3 to 6, I'm going to bump mine up. In fact, it's almost like the less if you want to call it, I don't want to call it distraction, but for lack of a better term, I will. All right, I don't mean that in a negative way. Yeah. The less distraction I have, or whatever you want to call it, the more I can focus on what I'm doing. And that's my personal preference. I know it varies from station to station. They may watch me. I don't know. I don't know what their forecast was with this last system. All I know is we went 1 to 3 inches here, and then like Route 15 and east, we went 3 to 6, and for the most part, we verified. So I'm happy with that. Tomorrow's a new day. That's how I view it. I have not met Dave Tolleris personally. I'm aware of what he does. I think that the way to put it is that he is a very knowledgeable meteorologist.
I think that a lot of people just question how he goes about in dealing with the public and how he deals with people on the site. But I don't actively read his posts or what his insights or whatnot. I mean, at the same time, though, this is a field where you're always going to be learning. I mean, there's never a ceiling where you're like, okay, I've learned all the meteorology there is, so now I'm going to go ahead and make my job. You know, but I just, it's just my approach to things.
Right. The reason I bring it up is there's been in the news and so forth, and in your trade, that he's particularly accurate with his forecast.
Right.
I mean, smokes everybody in Richmond constantly, and maybe on the East Coast, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Might be a little much there, but I just want to know. I'm trying to figure out who the guy is.
Right. Other than his Facebook page, that's all I know.
Lots of big corporations, and he makes a ton of money doing it.
Yeah, I know he does a lot of private forecasting and a lot of private consulting, but as far as anything beyond that, couldn't tell you. So, yeah, in the back.
As a weather professional, do you get value out of some of these like lightning triangulation type networks that have been set up to... sample that across I've seen some of those with a range of that, just sampling the impulse of the RF that comes off maybe under 1 megahertz, it's just an incredible range across the continent. And then they correlated and they map it and everything.
One of my friends at Penn State made his own homemade lightning detector out of an old AM radio. There is a giant network. Of course, there are some sites you got to pay for. We do not, as a station, subscribe to any to show them on the air, but there's a webpage. I think it's lightningmaps.org. That is fantastic. And I'll use that as cross-reference, because if I'm looking and I see bands of what I think might be thunderstorms, I'll be like, do they have any lightning strikes associated? I'll go, again, cross quality control, cross-checking. So, again, whether it's lightning strikes or temperatures or snowfall totals, like any information, it just makes it easier in some regard. We can use it in some way, shape, or form. So, yeah, there's a lot of value in that. Very much so. Yes, I'll come over here.
You're up at 2:30, so take us through the preparation process for your first broadcast.
Okay. Well, I'm out the door at 2:45. I actually get to work at 3 o'clock. From 3 until 3:25, I'm making the forecast. From 3:25 to 3:35, I'm in the radio booth recording our feeds for Monticello Media, which is Hit Kicker 99.7, News Talk 107.5 and 1260, Hot 101.9, Generations 102.3, and ESPN 1450. Then what I do, from 3:35 until about 4:20, I update our social media sites. I then make all the graphics that you see on TV. At 4:30, because we're... this is all me.
People.
All me. And tomorrow will be no exception.
You're looking at them all.
Yeah. I'm the one-man road show here.
Sounds like my job.
Social media, Twitter, Facebook, mobile app. We actually send out a little like text forecast at 5 o'clock. I do that until about 4:20. Now, because we are CBS, Fox, and ABC in one building, from 7 to 9 a.m., we have two morning shows. We have CBS This Morning and Good Morning America. We only have one studio, one set of equipment, so we have to record one of the sets of weather cut-ins. Usually they're ABC. CBS is our full power signal, so we tend to put more of our emphasis on that. So at 4:30, I will then record a 15-second weather, a 20-second, a 30-second, a 1 minute, a 120, a 55-second weather, and then we have our 24-hour weather channel on cable 209. There's two 1 minute and 45-second weather segments that run there. After that, I type in closed captioning. I will then put my graphics in order for the show.
Where does the coffee play into this?
coffee, well, here's the funny thing. It's only been about a year and a half, almost 2 years, I've been a coffee drinker.
Oh, that's it?
I'll be 39 next Saturday, and it took me, I lived 37 years of my life without coffee.
Wow.
Dang. I don't know why or how, but I finally woke up and smelled the coffee beans. But usually around 3:05 is when the coffee gets going.
You didn't, sir.
That's fine. So there's closed captioning. I got to get all my graphics in order that I want to show. I have weather segments every 10 minutes from 5 to 7 o'clock. And, of course, if there's weather beyond just your average sunny and 75, that's going to throw everything out of whack. I'll do live cut-ins as well for the radio stations. Then from 7 to 9, I'll do the weather cut-ins
every half hour on CBS. So there's one at 7:28, 7:58, 8:28, and then 7:58:30. No, 8:57:30 is the last one. My lunchtime is 9 to 10:30. I then come back and do most of that again leading up to our 12 noon newscast, and then I am free as a bird at 12:20, 7:46.
That's how you have to do your lunch break, though. You could revise your forecast, correct?
And oftentimes I do. In fact, I'll make modifications even during the morning show, like this morning especially was a good example. I made some minor tweaks, especially how long I thought any flurries would last. And again, a lot of it too is just now casting, like, hey, clouds are sticking around. Let's make some updates. So I'm constantly, amidst everything I'm doing, I'm constantly updating the forecast. And then I usually go to bed, usually, sometime around 7:30. Wife comes home from work. She works for UVA, like 5:15. So I see her for 2 hours every weeknight, but we spend time on the weekends together. So it's kind of a balance with that. So that is a day in the life of me on a weekday.
Wow. You're not allowed to get sick, are you?
Not now, because we don't have a weekend person. Yeah. And oddly enough, it was back in mid-June. And I'm not kidding you. It was after I spent a week in Idaho, Montana. And I kind of set myself up for this. I pretty much drank nothing but coffee and didn't have enough water. So the Tuesday after I got home, 4:10 in the morning, I'm sitting in my chair. All of a sudden, right here, sharpest pain I have ever felt in my entire life. I'm like, oh, God, I'm passing a kidney stone. So I basically did the morning's newscast with a kidney stone passing. If you ever had a kidney stone, it's not the most comfortable thing in the entire world. I have never felt pain like that in my life. Well, it always makes for a better story in the end, you know? That's my logic. No matter what bad stuff happens, if you can make a story out of it, it's great. But yeah, so I've done the weather with a kidney stone before. I've done it with the flu. Back when I was first starting out, I got dumped by my girlfriend 30 minutes before a newscast. Like, but hey, once the news is on, like a stewardess, man, paint on smile as you board. Doesn't matter about anything else, man. Just it's all part of the business. So yeah, thankfully, I have a clean bill of health and a decent bill of health, and have started drinking more water. But it's tough sometimes, because believe me, even the night before, I'll make the call around 5:00. If I'm not feeling well, I'll make the call at 5:00. So that way, my fill-in guy has heads up and he can get to bed and cover for me the next morning. Yes.
It seems to me, when I think about weather maps, any graphics I've seen have always been two-dimensional.
Mm-hmm.
Does it make any sense, would it have any value for anybody to have a three-dimensional model that shows what's going on at different altitudes?
I thought about that, but that's when the world of television comes in. And I say the world of television.
Meteorologist world.
Right.
As opposed to.
More the operational people will use three-dimensional base maps and just views of things. In television, we are told not to, not we specifically. Fortunately, we do not have consultants that tell us what to do, and I'm very thankful for that. But a lot of other stations will say, okay, you need to remember, yes, you are a scientist, but you need to keep in mind your general audience. Basically, they want to know, is it raining? What's temperature? What's forecast? What's 7-day? And if you can build your TV presentation around that, keep it as simple as possible. If you want to do 3D, that's great. If you want to do 2D, that's great. But in a lot of applications outside of television, when you're doing computer modeling or graphic or working on the computer guidance models, you have to do it in three dimensions.
So that's something that we would, as an average user, would probably never see.
Exactly. Exactly.
Aviation forecasting is a big deal.
Very much so. Yeah, you're talking turbulence and whatnot.
Great.
Yeah.
Thank you, Bradley.
Sure.